Let's explore how convergent trajectories apply to butterfly and backstroke this time. Recall that flexion and extension avoid intersecting with the midline to create these relatively straight trajectories. Flexion and extension are both utilized by fly and backstroke pulling. Let's prove this concept by using a band. Here I am pushing out against a glute band to ensure that I am moving away from the midline. From there, shoulder flexion is performed by reaching up and back. So far, this looks familiar. Open chest, arms overhead, and most especially, no crossing over the midline. But what about the hand position? The hands can act independent of the other segments. So the hands here are responsible for catching resistance that mimics the resistance of a band. The outer part of the hand is best positioned to catch the water resistance. To prove for shoulder extension in the propulsive phase, I visualize my arms going behind the back while using a band. Pay attention to the elbow bend and the stretched band. If I were to use a breaststroke type of pull, the band is surely to lose tension. Which makes sense since we have established in a previous video that breaststroke pulls prefer aiming for the midline. My focus therefore is not on the elbow bend. I focus rather on pushing the pinkies into the band while I continue to pull my shoulders into extension. Eventually, this down and back position will be maxed out. So how do we transition back into the recovery? Remember that we are constantly putting pressure on the pinkies as if we are pushing on a band. So to end the propulsive phase, we release that energy into the recovery, which gives us this sideward exit. Once again, let's highlight our concept of intention over form. The outstretched hands may look like a textbook example of shoulder abduction, but remember that we are trying to momentarily resist the downward force of gravity to keep the hands out of the water. This is best done through shoulder flexion, which allows us to momentarily resist the downward force of gravity to keep the hands out of the water until it is time to land it into the water. This is where we introduce the snap and go concept of fly and back. Before the kick snaps down, we have already maxed out upward rotation of the scapula. The arms are already fairly straight. So as soon as the kick snaps down, the hands can engage the catch. There is no time wasted in getting stuck in shoulder flexion. There is an immediate effort to execute the propulsive phase. The concept of snap and go also marks the start of the recovery. As soon as the second kick snaps, the upper body switches into the overhead recovery immediately. No time is wasted in pulling behind the back some more when the kick has already snapped. In backstroke, the snap and go phenomenon is guided by the rotation of the body. In this drill, observe how the kickboard is fully dipped in the water for every rotation. Digging in with rotation puts increased pressure on the outside of the hand. Let's use the band again for proof. Here I am replicating the water's resistance by spreading the band. Against this resistance, I try to go into shoulder extension. Again, the elbow bend is not my focus here. I am focusing instead on constant resistance on the band and the downward rotation of the scapula. This is the same downward rotation explained earlier. This action is continued to keep the hands in the water. Similar to butterfly, tension is released, which indicates the start of the recovery phase. Given the snap and go principle, the alternate hand will start its propulsive action as soon as the rotation snaps to the other side, and the cycle continues.